Well, good morning once again. Before we get into today's sermon, I do want to introduce my good friend Lane. And Lane is going to come and share with you a little bit about our Three Circles class that we are offering here at Growing Oaks. That's led by Pastor Victor. And Lee's going to come and share. I'm sorry, not Lee. Lee's over here somewhere. Lane, come on.
Good morning. I appreciate everyone coming out and enjoying the baptism. I want to take a minute and talk about the Three Circles class, what it is, what it's not.
Sam, hold up. Put up your... Put up your... There you go.
Okay, sorry. The Three Circles class is a way to transition an everyday conversation into a gospel conversation. What it is not going to be a public speaking class because everyday conversations are not public speaking. It will help you transition that conversation and discuss your faith. It's just a way to become comfortable in sharing your faith and how to be a bright spot in the dark world in which we all live. It's a great way to grow your faith and become edified in the process of sharing the good news. I was fortunate to be in the first class and, you know, do that. But the next class starts March the 3rd at the 11 o'clock hour. So it's a way to come do the first service, then hang around for the second class. And I would think that everyone, a person of faith, that should learn to grow and become edified in sharing the good news and carrying the Great Commission forward. So it's a very simple, basic class, and I think everyone can learn something from it. So I definitely recommend it. I enjoyed it, and I'd like to see the classes running over. So if you consider it, I think you'd be rewarded for your time. So thanks. I appreciate your time. Thank you.
Let me ask you all something this morning. How many of you were alive in 1969? Some of us are like embarrassed to tell how old. I need to put my arm down. I was not alive in 1969. Hey, a couple of months ago, I had the opportunity to watch a great movie that is called Jesus Revolution. How many of you have seen the movie Jesus Revolution? If you have not seen that movie, I encourage you to go and watch it. I just want to show you the trailer of that movie, and I'm going to talk real briefly about it.
Hey, Square.
I am not a square. I
think we should invite Greg this
weekend. I'm not in the movie.
What's his name?
Hey, Square.
I am not a square.
I think we should invite Greg this weekend.
What's this weekend?
These people are hippies, rebels against old-fashioned authority.
I think these kids need help.
They need is a bath.
You're passing judgment on people you know nothing about.
Maybe that's why your church is so empty.
When God walks in here, brings me a hippie, I'll ask him what it's all about. Because I do not understand.
His house has a very good vibe. There is an entire generation searching.
Slow down, man, slow down.
Just in all the wrong places. If you want to reach my people, you need to speak to them in a language they understand.
If I bring them in, I'm going to lose my job.
We can only walk through doors open to us. In your church, that's a door that's shut.
You've probably noticed we have some guests here today. I'd like you to meet my new friends. Welcome.
They don't belong here. Half of them aren't even wearing shoes.
They're staining the new shag carpet.
They need our help. If you feel like you're misunderstood and judged, you will find forgiveness and freedom right here.
That was awesome.
Now that door is open any time of day. And if there are some who don't like that, well then that door works both ways.
All right, Pastor, let's begin.
I was almost done with this, but then you did what nobody else would even dare.
This thing that we found, I feel like I belong.
You're gonna need a bigger church.
Country is a dark and divided place, but now there's hope and it's spreading.
This is your home, and I want you to tell all your friends about it.
G- Jesus Revolution is the true story about two primary men, Chuck Smith and Lonnie Frisbee. Chuck Smith was the pastor of Calvary Chapel in Costa Mesa, California, which was an aging, declining church, but ultimately opened its doors to a generation of hippies. The other primary character in that movie is a guy by the name of Lonnie Frisbee, who was a hippie who thought that true happiness was found in drugs and sex and rock and roll and love and peace. But Lonnie Frisbee got his hands on a Bible, and when he read the Gospels of Jesus Christ, he surrendered his life to Jesus. And Lonnie Frisbee saw his generation the same way that Jesus saw his generation, as sheep without a shepherd. And it was Chuck Smith's step of faith by opening the doors of his church to that generation that launched an incredible movement of God. And through that step of faith, over 1,000 churches were launched and planted through Calvary Chapel. In one of those scenes that you saw in the trailer this morning, the reporter for the Times magazine says this: "Our country is a dark and divided place, but now there is hope and it's spreading." Jesus Revolution is a great movie on how critically important the Church of Jesus Christ is to our culture and our generation. If you were here last week, you will remember that we began a new sermon series that is titled Passion Week. And Passion Week is a phrase that describes the last 7 days of Jesus' life on earth. And Passion Week is considered the 7 most sacred days of Jesus' life. If you were here last week, you will also remember that we kicked off Passion Week by looking at Palm Sunday. As Jesus rode that donkey into the city of Jerusalem, and as the crowds cheered him, praising him as the coming king, the coming Messiah of Israel. But my friends, Jesus did not come on a white horse to conquer. Jesus came riding on a donkey, which was a symbol of humility. That Jesus did not come to be king, that he entered the city of Jerusalem to die for the sins of the world. So this morning we're going to look at Monday of Passion Week. And this morning we are going to look at Mark's Gospel chapter 11, verses 9 through 19. So you have a Bible with you this morning. We'll be in Mark's Gospel chapter 11, verses 9 through 19. If you don't have a Bible with you this morning, that is perfectly fine. You can follow right along on the screen behind me. Before we read there, let us pray. God, we just come to worship you today. And God, we thank you for your presence and for your grace with us in this room. Holy Spirit, I pray that you will touch, minister, guide each life. Holy Spirit, speak a fresh word of revelation to us through your word. We pray this and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Before we get into Monday of Passion Week, I do want to go back and just briefly review Palm Sunday, because it sets up the context for what Jesus is going to do on Monday. Mark's Gospel, chapter 11, we'll begin at verse 9. "Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest.' Jesus entered Jerusalem and went to the temple. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. What I want you to notice in verse 10 is what the crowds were proclaiming as Jesus came in to the city of Jerusalem. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. what the crowds in Jerusalem are cheering for is for Jesus to come into the city of Jerusalem and to make Israel the way it was when David was king. Because under the kingship of David, Israel experienced an incredible time of political power, military power, freedom, peace, and material and economic blessing. This is what they want again. They want the Romans out of their country, and they want Jesus to come and to establish David's kingdom again. You see, in the eyes of the Jewish people, the greatest evil in their land was King Herod. And in the city of Jerusalem was Herod's palace. And Herod's palace was the biggest structure in the city of Jerusalem. And it was from Herod's palace, which was the central site of the political and military and economic power of the Roman Empire. What they want Jesus to do is to get rid of Herod and bring back David's dynasty to Israel. So if you are going to bring back David's dynasty to Israel, King Herod has got to go. So the Jewish people think that the greatest evil in their land is King Herod and his palace. So on Monday morning, when Jesus comes into the city of Jerusalem, rather than going left and going to Herod's palace, Jesus goes right and he goes to the temple in Jerusalem. And that brings us to Monday of Passion Week, where we pick up in verses 12 through 19. The next day, as they were leaving Bethany, Jesus was hungry. Seeing in the distance a fig tree in leaf, he went to find out if it had any fruit. But when he reached it, he found nothing but leaves, because it was not the season for figs. Then he said to the tree, "May no one ever eat fruit from you again." And his disciples heard him say this. We will look at this next week on Tuesday, picking up in verse 15. On reaching Jerusalem, Jesus entered the temple area. And I want you to notice three things that Jesus did. Number one, he began driving out those who were buying and selling there. Number two, he overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. And finally, number three, in verse 16, and would not allow anyone to carry merchandise through the temple courts. And as he taught them, he said, "Is it not written, 'My house will be called a house of prayer for all nations,' but you have made it a den of robbers." The chief priests and the teachers of the law heard this and began looking for a way to kill him, for they feared him, because the whole crowd was amazed at his teaching. When evening came, they went out of the city. The temple in Jerusalem was the central site of the religious practice of the people of Israel. The temple in Jerusalem was the place you went to sacrifice an animal to make atonement for your sins. The temple in Jerusalem was where you went to pay your tithe. The temple in Jerusalem was the place where you went to pay your temple tax. The temple in Jerusalem was the place where you went to pray and to worship and to connect with God, because it was believed this is where the literal presence of God dwelled. And not only that, you had prophets and teachers of the law who preached the word of God and taught the word of God in the temple. So if you wanted to hear the preaching and teaching of the word of God, you would go into the temple in the city of Jerusalem. What was going on in the temple in the city of Jerusalem sounds very much like what is going on in the church today. But when Jesus goes into the temple, he sees a greater evil that is happening here than what is happening in Herod's palace. So Jesus, in a fit of righteous anger, began to turn over the tables of the money changers. He drove the animals out of this area, and he began to tell people, quit taking shortcuts through God's temple. Jesus is cleaning out the temple because the evil that was happening in God's house was more evil than what was happening in Herod's palace. There are three things why Jesus was very, very angry. Here they are. Number one is that the Jewish leaders had created a special currency that could only be used in the temple. So when you brought your common money into the temple to pay your tax or to pay your tithe, there was very high exchange rates and fees to take your common money and to turn it into the money of the temple. And it preyed on the poor and the foreigner. People struggled to give their tithe in worship to God because they could not afford the very high exchange rates and fees. Number two, people who came to the temple were pilgrims, and because they would travel great distances, they couldn't bring a sheep or birds to sacrifice for the atonement of your sins. You had to buy their animal, and the cost of their animal was very expensive. Y'all, this is the $15 hot dog at the ballpark. And then we put a lot of salt on it, so now you've got to buy the $15 beer. They know they got you. People could not come and properly worship God by making atonement for their sins because they could not afford the animal. People are being prevented from worshiping God. And finally, number three, the temple in Jerusalem was a massive structure. It took up a huge portion of the eastern section of the city of Jerusalem. And where this is happening, where Jesus is cleansing the temple, is happening in an area that is known as the court of the Gentiles. And in the court of the Gentiles, only Gentiles and Jewish women are allowed in this area to worship God. The further you got into the tent center of the temple in Jerusalem, the more restrictive it came. So in order for people to travel quickly through the city of Jerusalem, they would take a shortcut through the court of the Gentiles. How could people come and pray and worship and connect with God with all the noise and commotion that was happening in the court of the Gentiles? There was so much noise and hustle and bustle. You couldn't come in here and pray. The atmosphere of this part of the temple made it impossible for Gentiles and Jewish women to come and to worship and to pray and to connect with God. The greatest evil in the eyes of God was not what was going on in Herod's palace. The greatest evil in the eyes of God was what was going on in his temple, the house of God. And that is why Jesus went into the temple instead of Herod's palace. What I want you to see in this text is how passionate Jesus was for the things of God. Jesus was passionate about people's ability to come and worship and pray and seek and be intimate with God. Jesus was passionate about people's ability to thrive and grow and flourish in their relationship with God. I think this text is a warning for the church in America. Judgment begins at the house of God. Not our culture, not in our school systems, not in our government. The judgment of God begins in the house of God, which is the church. Because the church is a place that is called to have its arms wide open. Jesus has put this church in Reidsville, North Carolina, to be a place where people can come and worship God, to encounter his presence, to pray, to be encouraged, to be built up in their faith, to be stirred and encouraged, to do good works in the name of Jesus. My friends, we are called to be a channel of the love of Jesus to our community, our city, our county. I came across this research study from Barna. And man, I couldn't believe this. But 86% of people in this study said that they have a favorable view of Jesus. Wow! I couldn't believe that. 86% of Americans have a favorable view of Jesus? That's amazing. But in that same research, they asked a different question. What percentage of people do you think said that they had a favorable view of the church? Yeah, 11%. Do you know what that tells me? We had better make the church about Jesus and not about us. We had better make the church about the things of God and not about us. When we open wide our arms and we welcome people to Jesus' love and grace and mercy, when we honor God by living his word, my friends, the name of Jesus is glorified. And that is what people are drawn to. The goal of the church is not to be an institution of rules and regulations. The goal of a church is to bring people to the lordship of Jesus Christ. The ultimate goal for the church is to see people having a deep, thriving, flourishing, growing relationship with Jesus Christ. The ultimate goal for a real church is to see people's lives transformed by Jesus. I have shared this with you before, probably at least 2-3 times at least. But here's the reality of the community in which you live. 7 out of 10 homes in the city of Reidsville are unchurched. 2 out of every 3 homes in Rockingham County is unchurched. This ain't the Bible Belt y'all living in anymore. This is our generation. Amen? Listen. Our greatest competition on Sunday morning is not Fairview Baptist Church or First Baptist or Covington or Reidsville Christian or Osborne. Nope. Do you know what our greatest competition is on a Sunday morning? Bojangles. And Lake Reidsville. Gang, if it was May or June, and it was a beautiful morning, what would people out there be doing right now? Washing their car? Cutting their grass? Working in their garden? What matters most to God? It is people coming to Him and worshiping Him through His church. And that is why Jesus' anger was so needed. My friends, the arms of God are wide open to come and to worship Him and to grow into Him. And any barrier to this opens us to the judgment of God. Just want to give you 4 ways in which God can use your life for His sake in this generation. And then I'm going to tell you why. So number 1 is this. Outreach begins in this room on Sunday morning. Because every week, God sends us gifts. And those gifts are first-time guests or newly returning guests. Obviously, God drew them here for a reason. People who are looking for a place where they can plant their roots and grow and thrive in their relationship with Jesus. And one of the things that can go a long, long way is making people feel like they are welcomed and noticed. So here is my challenge for those of you who are members of this church, or perhaps you call this church home, that we on Sunday morning should be looking out for faces that we don't know, and we should go out of our way to welcome them here so that they feel welcomed and noticed in our church family. So go out of your way to introduce yourself to people that you don't know. Invite them to your life group. Welcome them here with open arms. Number 2 is this. Invite people to church. I always keep in my wallet one of these little business cards that has Growing Oaks, our worship time, our location on it. And as I am out and about, and as I run into people, and maybe I don't have a whole lot of time, but I will pull one of these cards out of my wallet and I will invite them to church. All I am doing is planting the seed. We have these business cards back at the Connection Center grab you a few of them, and as you encounter people, invite them to church. Number three is something that is called bridge building. And this happens when we intentionally build bridges into the lives of the people who are around us. People like our neighbors, people like our coworkers, people who are on our kids' sports teams. And when we befriend them and we build a bridge into their lives, it opens the opportunity for us to share Christ with them or to bring them into the fellowship of our church. In the late 1940s, in Latrobe, Pennsylvania, there was this awkward, geeky, sick little kid. And because he really couldn't go outside and do anything, and because he was stuck at home, he didn't have any friends. So he created these imaginary characters, and they became his friends because he didn't have any. But when he went to high school, he was befriended by the captain of the football team. And now he was in. He was cool. And it was also at this time in his life when he gave his life to Jesus. So after he graduated high school, he went to Pittsburgh Theological Seminary and earned a Bachelor's of Divinity. And then he went and became an ordained Presbyterian minister. But this sickly, awkward, geeky little kid never pastored a church in his life. See, what he didn't like was what he was seeing on television. So Fred Rogers created a television show that taught Christian morals and values and principles. And for 33 years, we were blessed with Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood because the captain of the football team built a bridge into his life and changed him forever. And finally, number four is personal evangelism. You are called to be a missionary where you personally tell people the gospel and lead them to a place where they can make a decision to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Tim Brown was working as an engineer for a large corporation, and his boss's name was Matt. And Matt was a smart and assertive and an ambitious individual. But because he was so assertive and ambitious, he would just steamroll people. And it created a lot of conflict and stress in the office. So Tim Brown believed that what Matt needed was Jesus. So he began praying for Matt's salvation. One day they were in their office having a meeting, and when the meeting was over, Matt said to Tim, "Tim, I've noticed something different about you. You show grace to people, and I don't understand why." Tim was terrified, yet he thought, "This is my opportunity." So Tim began in Genesis and Genesis 3 in the fall and went right on through to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And when he was done telling him about Jesus, Tim asked Matt, "Would you like to follow Jesus?" And Matt looked him right in the eye and said, "Absolutely not." Well, in time, the company was sold, and Tim Brown went on to a new company. But a few years later, Tim was in his office working when one day he received a call from Matt. And Matt said to him, "Hey, Tim, I've been seeing a counselor, and he wants me to reach out to some of my old employees and ask for some feedback on my leadership style. So they set up a time and a place where they were going to meet over a meal. So Tim began to pray for Matt. And he also began to scribble up some notes on how Matt might be able to improve his leadership style. As they sat down together, it was just small talk. And Tim asked, "So Matt, how are you? How are things going?" And Matt just broke down and began to weep. And Matt had told him that he had put all of his hope in his career, but it was failing him. And Tim said to him, "Matt, you're a great engineer. And I can give you feedback on your leadership style, but we would not be solving the problem. Matt, I think the creator of the universe is after your soul." And he shared the gospel with him right there in that restaurant. And Matt surrendered his life and gave it to Jesus. This is why we are here. To take the gospel to people like Matt. It is said that on average, we have 27 conversations a day. That is 189 a week. So let me ask you this. When was the last time you had one with someone about Jesus? Can I just give you a challenge this week? Could you have just one conversation with an unbeliever about what it means to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? Have coffee with a friend. Do you know someone who's going through a hard time in life? Just say to them, "I am here for you." Listen to what is going on in other people's lives and love them. Why? Let's talk about the why question. Why? Because the church is the hope of the world. My friends, the church is not a building. The church is a people who is living on mission with Jesus. How does the name of Christ spread into the world? Through you. How do people grow in their faith? By planting themselves into the church. What I want to stress to you this morning is how critically, critically important this church is to our community. The church is a life-giving place where people can connect and encounter the presence of God, where we can worship and pray and serve God and grow in Christ and be encouraged to be a follower of Jesus by one another. Do you want to know what matters to God? Just look and see what mattered to Jesus. Let's pray. God, as we bow, in this moment of prayer, God, I pray for Growing Oaks Community Church. God, I pray for each and every single one of us in this room. God, I pray, would you open our eyes? Would you allow us to see that the people around us today are the generation that you are calling us to reach with the gospel of Jesus Christ? God, we pray for our city. We pray, God, for Rockingham County. God, we pray today for the thousands upon thousands of people that if they were to die today, would spend eternity in hell without you. God, we pray for the salvation of our city. God, we pray for the salvation of Rockingham County. God, we pray that you would open the eyes of those who are lost and perishing without you, that they would see of their need for Jesus, and that they would come to the cross and be saved. God, save our city. God, save our county. God, save the people in our state. And God, we pray for a great work of salvation to sweep across the United States of America. God, save the lost, we pray. Perhaps it's you who is here today, that if you were to breathe your last breath today, that you would not know where you would spend your eternity. Would you open your heart to the Holy Spirit today? Would you allow the Holy Spirit to show you that you need Jesus? Take that step of faith. Believe in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and receive the free gift of his salvation. It's so easy. Do you believe in your heart that Jesus was the Son of God? Do you believe today that God sent his Son? He lived a sinless, perfect life, and that he died on the cross for your sins, and that Jesus was resurrected back to new life, and that he is seated at heaven right now with God? Do you believe that today? Then call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. Say to him today, God, I am a sinner. God, I need your forgiveness. God, I want the free gift of your eternal life. And Jesus, I surrender my life to you today. If you prayed that today, genuine in your heart, welcome to the family of God. The next step for you is the step of baptism. If you've made that decision today, just see me after church. I'd love to talk with you about the free gift that you can have in the name of Jesus. God, I thank you for each one who is here today. God, you know their heart. God, you know their mind. And Lord, I just want to pray a special prayer today for the Roach family. God, I thank you that they are here today. And God, I just pray for your loving and gracious arms to comfort them, Lord, as they go through the loss of their father. God, may you wrap your loving arms around them today. God, you know each one who's here today. May your Holy Spirit touch them, minister to them, and I pray that you will experience the love and joy and peace of Jesus Christ. May God bless you, my brother and sister in Christ. I pray this and I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. As we stand for our final song this morning, I'll invite our prayer team members to come forward. If you're here today and you would want to have someone pray with you, our prayer ministers are here to minister to you with the love and grace of Jesus. They're available to you. Come, let them pray for you and bless you. But let us stand as we close out our worship service this morning.